What's up, dude?
Hey.
Hey, man, you mind taking your shoes off?
Yeah.
Great. I already got everything set up, so come on in. I wanted to check the levels, but...
Not for me?
Yeah. Help yourself. We got some gluten-free lemon cake my friend made. Allison, shout out. And blueberry muffin from Starbucks.
Oh, that looks good.
Thanks. Over the tray, please.
Oh, yeah, over the tray.
Sorry. And thanks for taking your shoes off. Please, take your shoes off podcast.
Do. Blabbity blue. Scoop D. Oh, yeah.
Hey, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
We've met a few times.
Yep.
But it's always been, if I'm not mistaken, I've met you three times. And every time I've come up to you, I've said, hey, man, I'm Rick. Funny stuff. Just want to say nice to meet you.
Yeah.
And then I got out because I'll always linger. And yeah. I want to make sure I'm not lingering. Oh, I don't know if you noticed, by the way, I have two napkins for you. There's a wet one and there's a dry one.
I have to, quick shout out.
Go ahead.
I'm the only other person I know that does the wet and the dry.
You do a wet dry.
I swear to God.
I've never met another
and
wet
when
dry.
When you had this folded down, I'm like, how the hell did he know this?
Yeah, that's great, man. Because I didn't bring it up, I thought maybe you were thinking, why is there a wet napkin on my
tray? No, I mean, I'm using it. Great. So clearly I like it.
I can't see which one you're using.
Oh, yeah. I'm using the wet one. Great. So I like it.
Why and even I'll, have
and
a dry
in my
one?
Mind, I was like, I have to bring this up because... I'm impressed. You're the only other person I've ever met that does the wet and dry thing.
Yeah.
Because when you're done eating and your hands are sticky, you get it off with the wet. And then if you're still a little damp, then you go to the dry
mm-hmm.
one.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you do.
I also sometimes use the dry one if I want to, like, for my mouth.
Yeah. Dry is good for mouth.
Yeah. DGFM.
I'll go wet on my mouth sometimes, too. It depends.
So, Matt, you have a large Instagram following.
Mm.
And through having a large Instagram following, part of the game is ads, sponsors.
Mm-hmm.
What's that about, man? How's that? I mean, that seems incredible.
It's super cool. So I started my video entertainment career on Vine. Did mm-hmm. you ever have Vine mm-hmm. by chance? Making 6-second videos, of course, most of the audience probably knows this. And I was working at a restaurant at the time. And I remember I had like... I was filming Vines, I got this app called Vine. I was filming Vines in the kitchen with the workers and the busboys and whatever, just doing dumb shit. And I remember I got 200 followers fairly quickly. And I was like, geez, like who are these people that are following me? This is before, 200 followers in like a couple weeks. Then it went from like 200 to like 500. Then it went to like 2,000. And then it went to like 4,000. I'm like, dear God, I'm getting followers. I wonder why. It was just me being myself, being goofy, doing dumb shit. And then I got to like 10,000 followers, and I was like, "I'm huge, I'm a massive star right now."
Okay,
right, 10,000 people following me. This is
now. What
big.
Kind of star do you feel like? Were you out here to be an actor?
No, to be honest, dude, I know this is very vague. I was out here to do entertainment. I love entertainment as a whole so much. I used to do hosting for Radio Disney. I did radio hosting. I did live hosting. I toured in a band for 4 years. We can get into that. That was pretty fun. And then now I do make skits on social media. So I just, I'm obsessed with entertainment. I love entertaining in general.
And so, now you've made it.
And what was that?
You have 10,000 followers and you
and
feel
so now,
I've made
so
it.
Anyway, yeah. But like, you know, half joking, but I was in my mind, I'm like, gee, this is crazy. 10,000 people follow me.
What year is this? This has got to be 2015?
This is 2014.
Okay.
So then I get to a point where I have, it just keeps going and going, and I get to probably about 50,000 followers, and I get a DM from a brand. It was a sock company. And they were a sock company in the Middle East. And I wasn't sure if it was a scam at first because it's like this one girl goes, hey, I'm from, you know, this part of the Middle East and we're trying to promote these new socks. For $800, will you do a few different vines? And I'm like, $800 for a few vines? Of course I'll do that. Like, that's amazing. That was my first brand deal. So I just shot these vines showing off these socks. And
What was the first one you did? 6 seconds. How does it go?
6 seconds. I feel like it was probably like me like sliding in, like, you know, the Tom Cruise scene.
Of course.
Just probably me doing that and then boom, close up of the socks. It's only 6 seconds. You know, it wasn't even a hilarious video, but they just wanted to be seen in front of an audience of 50,000 people. So then as my audience grew, I started getting more and more deals, and it went from, you know, a lot of dating apps in the beginning. There was this one huge dating app called Badoo. and they do you remember Badoo by chance?
The only reason I know it is because I remember a lot of people were going like, check out Badoo.
Dude, they paid so much money.
Are you comfortable talking about what they paid?
Yeah, sure. Okay. Well, okay, so my Stan stocks or my sock deal was $800 for a few vines. Right. When I got into the closer to the million mark.
Million followers.
Those deals were probably closer to $5,000
per post.
Per post, $10,000 if it's like multiple posts. My buddy Casey was.
Casey James.
Yeah.
Good basketball player.
He had like 4 million followers at the time. And I remember he was getting like big deals. Like he was getting like $40,000 checks. And I was just kind of like, dude, like that is crazy. So yeah, I mean, clearly for a post, grabbing 10 grand a pop or for these bigger guys, $40,000 is insane.
And how many 10 grand posts are you being offered to do per month?
Well, back then on Vine, it got quite a bit. And the reason why I was favored over the majority of the Vine community is because these brands were looking for PG-13 content.
Right.
They didn't want rated R. They didn't want cussing, any racial jokes. They wanted just like good, wholesome, like comedy, I guess.
So you're outside, you're playing frisbee, right? And then you get a message and you're like, yo, what's up? It's a sock company.
Yeah.
We love what you do. You're PG-13. You got good abs. We like your content. We want you to do a post here. Do they say how much they're willing to give you right away? Is there a negotiation?
There's a negotiation. So back then, in the beginning stages, I didn't have a manager, so I negotiated myself. Then I realized that I didn't want to do that. So I signed with a man. Just because as a talent, you never want to play the bad guy. You want to always be liked, and you want to have your manager play the bad guy, and your manager's like, he's $100,000, or making up a number, and then you scale down from there. So for instance, I didn't know this, but I was being way underpaid back then. Mm-hmm. When I got a manager, he literally like quadrupled my income because he's like, dude, he goes, you now have, let's just say when I first started making good money, he's like, you now have 500,000 followers on Vine. Like you can be getting paid more than $2,000 for these posts.
The managers, the way that works is they take 10%. So yep. If I'm speaking to yep. those that aren't in the biz.
Yep.
So basically if you're getting an average of 10,000 a post, if he just ups you $1,001, you're making your money back. So yeah. It makes sense to have
exactly. Yeah. And so now I have a great manager and he, managing social media influencers is a massive business now because all these brands are dumping so much cash into influencer mm-hmm. marketing. And that's, to be honest, that's what I get to do for a living. So essentially, so-and-so has a TV show on NBC and they obviously get paid dollars from the network, but the network gets money from advertisers. My own TV show is literally on my cell phone. It's mm-hmm. my Instagram. And every five videos that you watch of mine, one will be a brand deal. I try my best to make it as organic and real to me as possible. And to be honest, I actually really enjoy making them because I don't do anything like I only do funny shit that I want to see anyway. So if a brand says, hey, will you post for this product and it has to be this creative, I'll just pass on it.
This creative. What is this creative? You mean a specific tone?
A specific tone.
That you don't want
to
do.
Yeah. Sometimes right. like they'll say, hey, like we want this tone to feel like they'll say we want to be this is more of an emotional campaign. So if you can go give like a jewelry campaign, we want you to surprise your mom with it and blah, blah. And I'm like, dude, I've built an audience doing dumb shit and doing comedy. I don't want to go have like soft music playing and surprise my mom with some earrings. That's not my thing.
Is that a made up example or is that a real one?
It's a real one.
Okay. I'd like to make a suggestion.
Okay.
If that opportunity comes back, the music with the earrings,
yeah.
I would love for you to do it.
Okay.
I would love for you to do that. Okay. And then after, post this clip and say, you don't even, I don't know.
I like where you're going with this.
I would love for you to have a list of 10 things that you've been offered that you refuse to do.
Yeah.
And I want you to write commercials for those, even if you're never going to do them.
Yeah.
And then post that or have it like with a newspaper or whatever.
Yeah.
And then when those come up, do them. And then just take that 100 G's from those 10 commercials or whatever the money is.
Yeah.
And give it to me.
That's not a bad idea.
But don't give it to me like, here's 100.
You want it in increments. You want it monthly. In increments of every single month. I get that. So you don't want it all at once.
It's not my money.
It's not your money.
No.
But like just monthly. Monthly installments.
Here's what we could do.
Okay.
Also, you know what? I didn't have a place to go with that, so I made a choice that said, give it to me.
Yeah.
I don't like the choice. Because now the game is about like, oh, you know, nothing's fun with that. Take that $100,000.
I'll tell you what. I think you'll find this interesting. So, by the way, I get your point. It's weird turning down $10,000 checks. I just did a job recently. I don't even want to say it because I actually appreciate I appreciate all the work that I get. Don't get me wrong. I don't take anything for granted. I did this job that was fairly embarrassing. And they definitely changed after I signed. They changed the creative a little bit more than I wanted it to. And I was in a rush to shoot this. And it wasn't my best job. But it was such a good check that I was like, you know what? I'm just going to take this job and I'm going to spend a chunk of that check to just really pump out some awesome content that my followers are going to really enjoy. And I did that. And so if ever I take a bad job that I'm like, a little bit embarrassing, not quite my thing, I'll take the check and I'll make sure to reinvest it in myself and to find really cool ways to shoot stuff.
And by the way, if I say anything that I shouldn't be saying or you don't want to, let me know.
We can edit it out.
But I messaged you a couple weeks ago about doing a podcast.
Yeah.
And you said, yeah, I'm going out of town to do an ad for blank, whatever it is.
Yeah.
And you said to me, I'm just going to take all of them while I'm still relevant. And yeah. I thought like, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I do stand up, right? I've been doing stand up. 2 weeks ago was my 12-year anniversary.
I've seen you live before.
Nice. Was it okay?
It was good.
Oh, thank God.
Can we talk about that really quick or am I getting off topic?
Yeah, I want to go back to this, but you go ahead.
So I saw you live. Your entire set was you were checking off your jokes on was that you?
Oh, yeah. That was a while ago, right?
And it was unique and it was so subble. I loved it. I thought it was great.
Thank you so much.
Big fan.
Thank you.
Okay, continue. Sorry.
So, stand up to me has been a dream. To make a living doing this thing is a dream, right? Now I'm doing it kind of. I mean, I'm in a one bedroom apartment, but I'm making a living from comedy. So it's great. Yeah. But I still look at it as this dream thing of something I want to be able to do one day. And I had a realization maybe a year ago that this is a job. And all the things I've turned down, not so many things, but a fair amount of things that I should not have because I wasn't ready or it's not good enough. And now I'm a few years later, it's still what's ready, what's good enough. And I realized it's a job.
Yeah.
It's a fucking job.
Yeah.
And just put out the content, put out this. I mean, obviously don't do stuff if you're not ready or not good, but if you're trying to perfect something or have a certain brand, who gives a shit? Nobody cares. Nobody remembers.
Yep.
You put out a special. No, it's done. Bye. It's done.
Yeah. You put it out and it's gone.
Also, there's not 15 channels anymore. Nobody sees. I was on an NBC show for 3 years. I don't know if anybody I know saw it. Yeah. You know, I'm sure a couple people watch an episode because, oh, Rick's on a show.
Yeah.
Nobody fucking knows.
Yeah.
Just do.
Because there's so much content.
So much.
There's hundreds of thousands of pieces of content and different ways of getting it. So you're right.
There's hundreds of thousands of pieces of content on Instagram per day.
So here's my question. What were you waiting for? What were you waiting for? What's your dream scenario and why'd you turn down these jobs?
The dream is to write and direct.
Okay.
I'd love to be in it. I love acting, but I want to make my own stuff.
Got it.
Stand up is a separate animal. Stand-up, I don't think is the dream, but I think I'll always do it. Stand-up is not intuitively easy for me. My peers, we both started around this. We all started around the same time. Everybody, I have about six friends that we all started. They've all done multiple specials. They're all blah, 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 blah. I don't know how to do stand-up. It's fucking so hard. I think I'm so funny and so good at it.
Yeah.
I don't know if they know that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I've experienced doing well before. It's very hard for me to be consistent with it, especially earlier. I'm getting better. But I know what it's like for this to be great, but I don't know how to do that. I don't know how to recreate that. I got to figure out how to connect with people. And I've kind of accepted, I've been doing it 12 years, what's going to change?
Mm-hmm.
That this is what it is. I'm not going to be selling out theaters,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not going to be connecting to the masses of people. I'm going to connect to some weird people that like this weird thing, and that's the best version of myself I could be. So I was trying to find ways of, I don't know. I don't know what, I just was, I you're not ready. That's just what I was telling myself.
Wow.
And now I've gotten to the point to where I still agree with that. I'm not. But like,
when would you be ready?
I don't know if I ever will.
What have you done in the entertainment business that you've gotten the most praise from? That you've gotten the that your friends have been like, dude, that was funny. Because and here's my example, and this is why I think people need to find what they're good at. Your Instagram stories are amazing, and they're really funny.
Thanks.
And when you're playing like a doctor in the room, and you're like, no, it's Dr. Glassman, whatever.
Oh,
when you're doing that bit,
the hotel.
Good morning to the Glassman party. My name is Karina. How may I assist you?
Karina, first, it's Dr. Glassman. And second, how are you?
I'm good. And you, Dr. Glassman?
Well, you know, the Vegas for the weekend, getting away from the wife and kids and, of course, all the surgeries. But listen, since I'm here with the boys and we're looking for a little extra time, we saw Carrot Top tonight. We ordered a pizza and some soup. I was wondering if we could get a late checkout.
One moment, please, for the front desk. They can arrange for a late checkout. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Good morning. Thank you for calling the front desk for quality assurance. This call is recorded. My name is Alyssa. How may I assist the Glassman party?
Alyssa, hi. Three things. First, I want to let you know it's Dr. Glassman.
Dr. Glassman, I apologize.
No, please. Secondly, I also have to let you know that we are recording this for quality assurance as well. And is that okay with you? We might post this on Instagram.
It's only fair.
Great. And third and most importantly, I'm on break with my boys, getting away from the wife to kids, cutting into people's shoulders. I'm a doctor. We got to get home tomorrow because I got an early call, knee deep inside this 13-year-old boy. But what I was wondering is, since I don't have to be home until the evening, maybe we could sleep in. Doctor needs his rest. Do you think we could check out around 5 p.m.?
Dr. Glassman, I do apologize. We cannot extend anything beyond our standard checkout time of 12 p.m.
I hear you. I'm wondering if you hear me. Maybe this will change your mind. I'm putting a $20 bill on the phone.
I do apologize,
doctor. Hold on, no, please say nothing more. I put another $5 on there. I won't tell anybody. You don't need to tell anybody. I get to leave at 12:30. I'm looking for a half hour.
12:30. Let's see, doctor.
You got it.
Glassman, can I place you in a very brief hold? Let's see if you can look into that.
Absolutely. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Of course. One moment. Dr. Glassman?
Do you have Dr. Glassman? Yes.
I was able to go ahead and secure a 12:30 p.m.
I appreciate that. Alyssa?
Yes.
Thank you so much. You have a good night.
Have a wonderful day, Dr. Glassman.
Thank you.
You as well.
Only in Vegas.
That's when I first started following your Instagram. I think Ariel had sent me that. Or sent me one before and I started following your Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
And like, that shit's so funny. And I'm sure people DM'd you about that because it's hilarious. But like, you're so naturally good at that. I don't know what we want to call that. I don't want to just call it, you're not, I don't want to say you're good at Instagram stories. You are good at them. But I'm saying like, what if you took that character, that person, and then put that into a TV show? Because that guy is ready.
So,
that guy is ready. Like, I would watch that character tomorrow on a TV show and it's hilarious.
Because I'm working on it. It's very hard to sell a television show.
Yes.
You know, that's the answer.
Yeah.
That kind of stuff is what my stand-up is. The thing that makes stand-up so hard is people are conditioned to what they're going to be laughing at, right?
Mm.
When you go to a comedy club, you're expecting jokes and laughs, so that's what you need to get. And there's a subconscious anticipation of what a joke is. And we could get into this. I think it might be a little boring, but I want to go from a macro point of view.
Yeah.
When you go to a concert and a musician is playing songs and he's fucking like, you know, and you're in, right? And then in between songs, he says like, yeah, I wrote that at my mother-in-law's, you know, I'd rather never have written this song than had to experience, you know, some bullshit joke.
Yeah.
People lose it because, oh, that's funny. They weren't expecting it, right? So my stand-up is a bit anti-comedy deconstruction, not in a way where I'm meaning to make fun of comedy or it's better than it. I just don't understand how to do stand-up. This is my interpretation of it.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what I do. So when four comics go up before me and they all have something in common in a good way, in a professional way.
Yeah.
They have a certain structure, they have certain left turns, they have certain punchlines. It's palatable, it's digestible. I know what this is.
Mm-hmm.
What I noticed, especially the first 7 years of my stand-up, was people didn't know I was joking. People didn't understand what this is, you know?
Yeah.
And what I learned was, and one of the biggest realizations that helped my comedy was, people don't intuitively question things. Guilty of it myself.
Yeah.
When you know something, that's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what it is. I'm paraphrasing this, but there's a Mark Twain quote that is like, the problem isn't people that don't know things. It's the people that know things and that just aren't so, or something like that. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense? Like, when I know something and I'm wrong, I'm done. Game over. So when people think, oh, this guy's weird or this or that, they're not going to read into any of my intentions. So with stand-up, my goal, bigger than laughs, the first thing I have to do is make them question stuff. Does mm-hmm. that make sense?
Yeah,
I get that. I have certain bits that I have to make them know it's real and then show that it isn't. And it's...
Well, I personally think that your stand-up, based on what I saw, I think it's for a smarter audience. I do, because... That's what was funny to me. And I realized some people in the crowd, some people just weren't getting it. People were just kind of like, oh, is he messing up? And you're like, you know, you're
Come on, man. It's a joke, dude.
It's a joke. You're playing the person that's not sure or whatever. I remember thinking that. I was like, that's amazing. I was like, that's genius. So I wonder if your stuff truly is just too smart for the masses. And there's a smaller group of people who would appreciate and get that. You know?
So I want to make sure there's a good enough balance, because there's so many things I want to ask you, and we're talking about this, and I don't need to, but I do. Yep. I'm enjoying this conversation.
Yeah.
I want to address the too smart thing. It's not about smart or not smart. Everybody has different frequencies, and you could look at one as smarter or better than another, but that's not what it is. And most people aren't this way, for better or for worse. Most people aren't this way. So you just have to. If somebody doesn't know anything about basketball, they could be a great basketball player, but you have to teach them. You have to give them an opportunity to appreciate it. So it has to be a give and take. And an audience isn't wrong. They're there for laughs. And if I'm not giving them laughs, who's that on?
Yeah.
So I think it has less to do with smart and more to do with, let me show you what basketball is. So there's a level of it used to be my first 5 minutes, and now I'm proud to say I do this in about a minute. My first job is to get them to question things and get them to trust me. And by trust me, I don't mean believe everything I'm saying is real. I mean for them to believe everything I'm doing is on purpose.
Yeah.
If you see someone trip and fall and then they're embarrassed, you feel for them and you're embarrassed for them.
For sure.
If they're laughing, you could connect to it. It has nothing to do with the action. It has to do with understanding or thinking, questioning their intention.
Yeah.
So stand up to me has been a psychological thing. It's not just about writing jokes. It's conditioning a room to understand and accept me, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And something what we all want to do. I don't intuitively understand when people understand me.
Yeah.
The first while, I always thought I was, even when people aren't laughing, when I was being funny, I thought I was killing.
Yeah.
I thought I was being so funny.
Yeah.
I would get people to come up to me all the time and they would say, I thought it was funny. And I think they were giving me a compliment by basically saying, nobody liked this but me. And I always thought, yeah, me too.
Yeah.
And then I realized, oh, you're saying that they didn't.
Well, the thing is, no, I truly believe that person is paying you a compliment. Like, for instance, when I watched your stand-up and I saw people are in the room being confused, I understood the joke and I understood that it was funny. That is a compliment. If someone says, I thought it was funny, then the room, that means they're laughing at jokes that the room may have been quiet.
Okay.
That's what I think.
I do want to just do a hard cut on this subject now, because thank you so much, by the way, for being so sweet about it.
Yeah.
But like, who gives a shit? You know. I want to talk more. I want to talk more about you're getting paid.
Yeah.
I'm making this number up, and you don't have to validate anything. But I'm going to say you don't even have a manager at this time. You're making about 30 G's a month on Vine, and then all of a sudden you get a manager. Vine is getting bigger. You're probably doing better than that. I don't need a job. Vine goes away. Instagram starts doing videos.
Yep.
And Instagram is a much bigger platform, has a much more followers, it's a much broader audience. Vine was for 14-year-olds. Instagram is for everybody.
Yep.
And now, and pardon my French, but cha-ching, because here we are.
Yeah, because here we are.
So you are, is it correct to say you are a professional Instagrammer?
Yeah.
That's your main source of income.
My main source of income is Instagram, 100%.
So you are doing, you're doing, selling socks and you're selling M&Ms and what, and alcohol and whatever you have to do, you're making bank. Mm-hmm. What you want to do is entertainment.
Yes.
You have X dollars put aside, and now what do you want to make? What do you do with that? What's the goal?
Well, obviously, we all want to make our own TV shows.
TV show. That's not obvious. A lot of people... TV... not movies. You want to do TV.
Not movies, TV.
What's your TV show?
So, but the thing is obviously it costs money to make them, and now that I do have money set aside to make them, I can make them. So, for instance, and before we talk TV show, I now have the capital to... I have an assistant now. I can now hire a lighting guy and a Steadicam guy, and I can pay for props, and I can now afford my production, because back then... You know, if I wanted to shoot something really cool, I couldn't really afford it. But now that I have the money, I can afford to actually hire a team to shoot and make sure the content's good. What I want to shoot now is, I don't know if you've seen these videos that I post on Instagram, the emo videos where I dress up as an emo guy. I have long shaggy hair. Mm. I wear like a black tight hoodie and black skinny jeans, and I sing these emo. I'm in a very emotional state, and I sing these emo songs every time like Ariel gets in the car. So I'll pick her up in the car. It shows me like,
yes, I've seen
me being super emo. She gets in the car. I turn and start singing a popular emo song. I posted my first one. I don't know, like a month ago, and it crushed. Like, the comments were crazy. People were like, this is so nostalgic. Like, I love this song. I was here when I heard the song first. Like, oh my God, tagging their friends. This reminds me of so-and-so. And I was like, damn, like there's a lot of traction here. So then I posted it to Facebook. I don't usually post all my stuff to Facebook because my Facebook until recently has just been trash. Like, it's really hard to get a hit video on Facebook. And then I posted it on Facebook, and it legit went viral and has over 10 million views on Facebook. So it went viral, and I was like, damn, dude. I was like, this is crazy. It's like, I'm going to test another.
Now, are people connecting to the music or the character?
They're connecting to the emo scene as a whole.
Gotcha.
This emo character, mm-hmm. the song. They obviously like, you know, the fact that me and Ariel, they know me and Ariel. So I think it's a combination.
Yeah, your relationship is very attractive.
It's attractive to the internet. They grew up with us from Vine on it. So they like seeing me and her, yeah. especially doing this thing. So anyway, I post my second video on Instagram. It dominates. I post it on Facebook. Another viral video, like 8 million views. And just to put it in comparison, my Facebook video views were around 10,000 to 20,000, mm-hmm. not 10 million. So then I was like, damn, I was like, I really think I have something here. I did two more. They're all, every single time wow. they go viral. So I was like, you know what? There's clearly something missing here. There's a market for it. There's definitely something missing that this audience wants to see. They want to bring back these emo songs from the early 2000s. They want to relive these moments, and like they want to kind of like watch something that's, you know, reminds them of their childhood. And a lot of people, millions of people, really like that emo era and that emo scene. So the show that I'm coming up with now, or that I'm actually creating, is, it's called Emo's Not Dead. And it's a mockumentary. It follows my character as Emo Matt. And I'm this guy who is, you know, I have a great job. I have a beautiful girlfriend, a beautiful house, but something's missing. And what's missing is I miss the nostalgia of those days when I would go to these emo concerts and their music like made me feel so
what's
much
an
better.
Emo band? I don't know.
My Chemical Romance, Taking Back Sunday.
You have them on your...
The Used. Yeah, so the one with me, like the gothic looking me. I think people like this because this wig looks like it looks real. It looks like it could be my hair.
Matt, it's freezing. Open the door.
Do you know this song?
I don't know anything.
Blink 182?
No.
So you miss this era then. I'll educate you on it. It's okay. Very fascinating.
Hello there. From my nightmare, the shadow in the background evermore.
Ariel is so big. her faces.
Oh.
The faces yeah. she makes are yes. so... She's a cartoon character.
Dude, so I call her that.
We open the door now.
Where are you? And I'm so sorry. I cannot sleep. I cannot dream tonight.
70,000 likes on this. How many and on Facebook, it's how much?
I think that one's 10 million. 10 million not likes, views. So.
Oh, right. Yeah, right. Yeah, so views. The views on that. What are your views? Because you could see them. I can't.
That might be 500,000 views, I'm guessing.
So Facebook is bigger for this.
Well, it's bigger. And dude, no joke. Facebook has been my smallest platform, but I think there's an older audience on Facebook that are anywhere from, I don't know, 30, 35, 40. That's the age, 30 to 40, that's the age of people that are familiar with this emo era and this emo scene. Because the emo scene was the early 2000s. It was like 99 all the way up to probably 2006.
Yeah, that's our age. How old are you?
34.
Same.
Yeah, so it's people our age, and either you were into it or you were not. I was into it, so I know all these bands, and there's no entertainment that's servicing these people. They want to see this. They want to hear those songs. So after
you sing, right? I feel like I've heard you sing on Ariel's stuff, and you have a good voice.
I used to play in a band, sing in a band. I used to sing in a band. Yeah,
play an instrument too.
I could play guitar.
So no. People that say I could play instead of I play, feels like...
the thing is, I've recorded on a professional album guitar before, but I'm not like a guy. I can do like the chords and like strum and sing. So yes, I can play guitar. I don't like to say I play guitar. I don't like to say that because I'm not that guy.
I understand.
And I'm not a good singer. I'm a good enough singer to sound good on an album. For real. So like... I know my voice sounds good recorded on an album.
Could you give us a little taste or something? A little lick? Two, three, four.
Oh, I don't want to scream. I was literally just going to do an emo scream.
Pull it away.
Where are you? And I'm so sorry. I cannot sleep. I cannot dream tonight.
Okay.
That's how emo guys do it.
Yeah, that was actually really good.
So no joke, the guy in the band, Blink-182, he's a better emo singer than me, but he does sound like that. And that's why people like that, because it's very...
What's that British thing at the end of it?
So it's very eccentric, and it's very, obviously hair in the face. It's very, I cannot sleep, I cannot dream. And it's like, there's like a thing behind it.
Yeah.
So when I started...
It makes me want to do it.
So when I started mimicking those characters on Facebook, people were like, holy shit, this guy's got it down. And the new one that I shot, it's not posted yet. The new one that I shot, I'm going crazy in the desert. I'm headbanging and I'm doing the mosh pit. I don't know if you've seen these mosh pits, but these emo kids will go and should I stand up and show you guys?
What do you think? What do you guys think?
What, you guys want to see? You guys want to see it?
Yeah.
Okay. Here we go.
All right. Here it is.
So I'll talk loud so you can hear me. But these emo kids will stand up in a mosh pit. So they'll literally swing their arms like this and headbang and swing their arms, and they'll literally punch each other in the face. No joke. They'll hit each other and someone will go down and get a bloody nose, but it's a community, so they'll all pick each other up and they'll sock each other in the face, in the back of the head. Some kid would go down and then the whole, like, everyone has to pick up that person. It's like
a fight club.
It's like a fight
musical
club.
Fight club.
It's like a...
I'll tell you something. There's your Broadway show.
Dude, a musical fight club.
Yeah, well...
Genius. It's a really great idea. Good. A musical fight club. I love that.
Good, man. Fucking good, dude.
So anyway... To kind of wrap up the story on the whole emo thing, I think this character can be bigger than just what's the minute videos on Facebook. So I'm going to film a mockumentary following him around, because he wants to bring emo back.
Here's what I want to do. Yeah. I want people to stop calling him a mockumentary. I know. You call it a documentary. Because the moment it's a mockumentary, I'm out.
So if you heard it's just a doc, if you saw my show that I put out and you're like, what's this documentary about? Then you want to find out later that it's fake.
It's fake. You're wearing a wig, dude.
Yeah, that's true.
Why are you trying to make everything seem real, but tell everybody it's fake?
Well, I guess the thing is, isn't a mockumentary a genre? Isn't that a genre of film now? Right?
Yeah. If you want to,
because, okay, let me put it this way. If I went to pitch Netflix right now on a documentary, and I said, it's a documentary, it's going to follow me around, and it's me bringing back emo, and then they signed the check, and then they found out that it's all fake, wouldn't they be pissed? Wouldn't they want to know?
Okay, so in this, first of all, I don't know if you know how pitches work, but that's exactly how it goes. You say, hey, I'm making a documentary about me bringing back emo music, and they go, yep, here it is, dude, and they give you a check.
That
no, there's development. There's notes. There's a script. There's a back and forth for a while. There's probably going to be, you know, what's the character's name?
He doesn't have a name yet. Emo Matt.
Okay. Emo Matt. 31, because we all make ourselves a little younger
in
scripts.
Of course.
Good looking, but doesn't try too hard. We all try that stuff, you know. How tall are you?
Spot on. I'm 5'11", so we're going to say 6'2".
Right, 6'2". Six foot.
Six, 6'2", yeah.
And it's going to say, long, ridiculous wig. You know? It's not
yeah,
real.
Yeah.
If they think that it's a real documentary, then you did your job.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
Do it. Make it real. So I don't understand. Is this a character you're playing? No. No, this is me. This is me. And I came in here and I cut my hair short because I want to be professional and respectful. But I mean, really, you're just kind of fucking, what do you say? Like, yeah, bumming me out, bro.
This is who I am.
Yeah.
This is who I am.
Yeah.
And when they see the documentary that I'm going to film, it's me.
Iron Man, they don't call Iron Man a CGI action flick. Yeah. You know? We know it's not real, man.
We know it's not real. Yeah.
But it's
based on a true story.
Respect what you're doing.
Actually, you know what? I've never thought about it like that because I just kind of went with the whole mockumentary thing. But you're right. Call it a documentary, and then Netflix can decide what they're going to label it. If they want to label it, do they professionally label it mockumentary? Or they say documentary?
What does labeling mean? I mean, Orange is the New Black's a comedy. You know, I mean, they say all there's these genres and subgenres and dramedies and to fit into certain categories. Listen, man, can't put me in a box.
Yeah. Stay out of that box.
Yeah. I had a buddy, no joke.
Yeah.
Had a huge box. He's like, yo, I wonder, could you fit in this? I said, probably. He said, can I see? What'd I say?
No.
Not getting in a box.
No, don't get in the box. Stay out.
I don't want a box.
No, hell no.
So, you know,
I get it. Yeah, you're right.
Plus, mockumentary to me has this kind of like, I've seen them.
It does sound cheesy.
It sounds like a fake video.
It does sound cheesy. So what if I just called it a TV series?
Listen, man.
I'm putting together a TV show, and it follows this character around, and it's him trying to bring emo back.
You're doing a documentary.
Documentary?
You're doing a documentary. Okay. And his name isn't Emo Matt. His nickname's Emo Matt.
Yeah. Well, that he doesn't have a name yet, so we just call him Emo Matt.
Great.
But
Matt Bruschel. I'm doing a documentary on him, who's this dude that lived this life. I want to say lives this life, but that life doesn't exist anymore. He just doesn't realize it. And he's blah, 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 blah. Yeah. Is this a real guy? Yeah. And you go like this. You go, yeah.
Got it. Then
you look to the side and wink. You go, yeah. And then if someone says, are you winking? What do you say?
I'm twitching.
Twitching.
Yeah. I'm having a spasm.
Mm-hmm.
Got it.
It's a documentary.
Okay. My next meeting with Netflix,
I'll follow that guy. I've been working on this doc, dude. And also, you shoot your thing, you show them, it's not you. So I kind of know him. I mean, he literally went to my school for like 8 months in fifth grade.
Yeah.
We reconnected, he saw my stuff, and I just wanted to follow him around. Check out this doc. Boom.
That's perfect.
Yeah.
That's great. Okay, done. It's a documentary.
Great.
I'm filming a documentary based on a guy who's bringing emo music back. And so do any of these names sound familiar to you? Taking Back Sunday.
No.
The Used.
No.
Secondhand Serenade.
No way.
Dashboard Confessional.
Big time.
You know them.
I've heard of them.
You heard them.
Okay. My first guess is it's a band. My second would have been it was an HBO show where you could see tits, but they're all ugly chicks.
Got it. Amazing. Okay, now kind of leaving the email era, have you heard of Yellow Card?
No.
They're more pop.
Okay, also, so, I don't know anything. I don't know things.
You just don't know things?
I don't know
why?
Things. Who gives a fuck?
Okay, so...
No, not who gives a fuck about you, why. I'm saying most things. Like, I don't... What, I'm going to listen to Yellow Card?
So, do you have a favorite band or favorite musician?
Yeah, I have favorites.
Okay. You only have a few favorites and everything else is just kind of like for some reason I know a lot of bands, a lot of musicians. I really pay attention to music because it was my life. I was in the industry, but I used to be that way of like I don't know anything because all I wanted to know was what I wanted to know. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to, like, I'm happy knowing this much shit. Mm. I don't need to know all this bullshit.
Mm-mm.
Then as I got older, I got more curious. Mm-hmm. So I started Googling things and learning more stuff. And it's fun, but it's also depressing. The more you know, the more depressed you can get. Because life can be really shitty. There's a lot of shitty people
out
there.
Wait, are we still talking about knowing about bands or just information?
Well, information now. Because you said, you know, I don't know anything. And I'm like, hey, I kind of used to be the same way.
As far as pop culture is concerned, I don't know things.
Yeah.
Because when I go to a restaurant, I'm not trying everything on the menu. Once I watch Fresh Prince, I don't need
the other shows. That's your thing.
Once I have, you know, Hans Zimmer soundtracks or Disney movies,
yeah.
I don't need anything. I got everything I need.
Yeah.
You know?
Is Disney your jam?
Yeah.
Favorite Disney movie? Favorite Disney movie, then favorite Disney movie song.
Well, it's between Lion King and Aladdin. I guess I'd have to say Lion King.
Bro, those are my top two.
That's also the same age. It's
Lion King is phenomenal. Aladdin and I Can Show You the World, very cliche. I get it, but that song is amazing.
Not cliche.
I'm actually going to do a skit with Ariel where we're both singing the Elton John Lion King song. The I'm gonna be a mighty king, enemies beware.
Well, I've never seen a king or beast with quite so little hair. I'm gonna
be the main event, like nothing was before.
Like no king was
like
before.
No king was before. I'm working on my roar.
Well, that's rather far an uninspiring thing.
Oh, I just can't wait to be king.
Dude, can I play piano for it?
Yes, can we do it?
Yeah.
Oh, right now or?
No.
Later. We'll do
it. Later. I've never played it.
We're comfy.
I don't have to figure it out at the moment.
Dude, okay, so you're going to be in the skit. This is perfect.
Great. Do you have the budget to get me the snout?
To get you what?
The snout.
Yes.
Also, I said Iago, which is the bird from Aladdin. What is Zaza is the bird in Lion King.
Zaza. And
Zarzar or something like that.
What does he say? Out of Blung, out of Africa. I've never had a doubt.
Yes. Yeah. I mean,
what does he say?
Well, we got to keep going. It's from the inspiring. Oh, I just can't wait to be.
Oh, I just can't wait to be.
Well, I never. No one's saying.
No one said do this.
Well, when I said that.
No one says do that.
No, what I meant was.
No one says dun, no, dun.
What you don't realize is.
Dun, 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 dun.
Now see here. Free to run around all day. Well, that's definitely out of the question. Free to do it
all my way.
Yeah.
Okay, so I got to learn those lyrics. I used to know them when I was younger, and I forgot them.
So I think,
but I love that song.
I think an easy way to do this is we are get preparing the audition for the Pendageous version of it.
I think
so. You could read the lyrics.
I think this was also an audition for you to be in my skit, and you nailed it. Great. You're that. You sounded great. You can carry a tone for sure.
I'm a very good piano player.
Are you?
Yeah. Like I'm like really, really, really,
really
good. Like I would say I don't want to oversell it, but I'm not that good of a salesman.
So you're just straight up.
Yeah,
you're just good.
You know how you go say I could play guitar, I could do a melody, but I can't. Yeah. Dude, I'm. It's fucking nuts. My hands would be a little bit lower. Pianos are usually and they're on one plane. No.
Oh no, shit.
No, yeah, that's the littlest chair.
Got it. Do you know what? I did this so the people could see right there, and I realized that they can actually say, hey guys, well, yeah, right here is fine. You'll do that shit too?
Yeah, I guess maybe I oversold a little. I'm a good piano player.
Okay.
Yeah, you probably know a lot of piano players that are better than me. I'm the best piano player you know that doesn't play piano for a living or didn't play for a living.
Got it.
And I'm better than a lot of those people too.
I don't know a lot of piano players. So you might be the best piano player that I know.
You'd be surprised how many people play the piano.
I know.
Do you?
No, I know how many people play piano because I go to parties
maybe you wouldn't be surprised.
At every single party, there's multiple people that are like, I'll play this song, I'll do this one. I'm like, how's everyone know how to play piano?
Everyone knows how to play a couple of songs or chord progressions.
Yeah, that's true.
And I gotta be honest with you, I'm a little judgmental about it because I'm wrong. But when I see people being applauded for
a mediocre performance,
it's not about a mediocre. I mean, most performances are mediocre.
Yeah,
it's not knowing it's a mediocre for thinking like check this out. It's like no, there's a way of doing it. There's a way of like downplaying it that is manipulative, but must be done.
Yeah.
Unless you're the man.
Yeah.
I'm gonna show you how to downplay.
Okay, show me.
I want to show you how to. If you didn't know I played, it's like, oh, wow.
Yeah.
So first thing you have to do is you have to like touch the piano a little bit and see if anyone says, oh, do you play? Yeah. And that way you get to be like, well, you know, and then you play. Yeah. But if they don't, you sit down and you squint and like and you play some of the keys and like, wait, what's, until someone says it. And if they don't, you just got to play quiet. You have to find a way of having somebody ask you to do it.
Makes sense.
Right?
I agree with that.
And I'll show you how to do that. All right. So... at a party, you want to come in, you got to do something like this.
Okay, let's see it.
It's a Yamaha. It's a Yamaha, right? Cool.
Yeah, you play?
A little bit, not really. I was just checking this out because A buddy of mine was looking to get a keyboard. Is this good? Is this out? Is this?
Yeah, it's Tom's.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, Tom's not here. Dude, play something, man.
I mean, I don't really want to play. I just want to see what it sounds like.
Yeah, go ahead, man. Have at it. Oh, bro, that's good. Hey guys, come check this out. This guy is good.
Sweeter than you, sweeter than you. And I will never find another lover more precious than you, more precious than you. Girl, you are close to me just like my brother, close to me just like my sister, close to me just like my neighbor, close to me just like my father. You are the only
close to me like my neighbor?
I had to fill it with something.
Mother, father, brother, sister. You put your neighbor in there?
You are the only on my everything, and for you the song I'll sing all my life. I pray for someone like you, and I hope that you feel the same way too. I hope you feel the same way too. Yeah, I hope that you feel the same way.
You promised to never fall in love with a stranger. You're all I'm thinking of. I praise the Lord above.
Nice.
Sending me your love. I cherish every love. I really love you.
And all my life, I pray for someone like you. And I thank God that I finally found you. And all my life, I pray for someone like you. And I hope that you feel the same way too.
I hope you feel the same way too, baby.
I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I play. It's. I don't know. A little. It's not, I don't know. But no, it does sound good though, and there's a good reverb on it.
Dude, yeah. That was actually really dope.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, and I don't even sing at parties like that.
No?
Never. That was dope, though.
Oh, yeah, that's cool. Do you want to start a band with me?
I'd love to start a band with you.
Do you know Yellow Card?
Yeah, I know Yellow Card.
Do you know Matchbox 20?
Yeah.
Do you know Dashboard Confessionals?
I know all of them, man.
Dude, those are some of my favorite
Literally
bands.
My favorite bands. Let's be the next Matchbox Yellow Card.
MBLC?
MBLC.
Great.
All right. Good to meet you, man.
Nice to meet you, too, man. Yeah. Hey, man, do you guys have any blow? We're going to get some blow.
Tom, the guy who owns the keyboard, he has the blow, right, but cool. He left.
That's how Hollywood parties are.
That's it.
Because everyone gets laid at a Hollywood party. I want to talk a little bit more about some stuff before we wrap it up, because we're at like that mark now where it's like, all right, wrap it up, boys. But I don't want to yet. I've got a couple questions.
Yeah, yeah.
Are you okay? I know you want to get out of here by traffic time.
I'm having fun. Listen. Honestly, I'm having fun. It's 2:16. If I could be out by 3, that's ideal.
What do you guys think? You think we should keep going? Come on, you could do better than that.
All right.
All right. All right. All right. We'll stay.
Let's keep going.
That'll be great. All right. So I want to know a little bit about Matt Casual Cutshall.
Yeah.
Pre-waiter.
Okay.
I don't know your family. I don't know, okay. Brother, sisters, where you're from. So I'm going to just ask you 3 questions.
Sure.
And then I'm going to be quiet for a few minutes and see how far this could go.
Got it.
1, 2, 3. All right. Where are you from?
Portland, Oregon.
Brother, sisters?
Twin brother, older sister.
Twin brother?
Twin brother.
What does twin brother do?
He's kind of retired right now. He worked his ass off for like 15 years for this corporate company that he just did not want to work for. Saved money, opened a coffee shop, raised. He had, now has 2 kids, and he just kind of checks up. He just checks in on the coffee shop every now and then.
Man, you and your brother are just chill, huh?
Yeah, we're chill.
That's amazing.
Well, why does that make him chill?
Why does a guy who has some kids and just checks in on a coffee shop every now and again chill?
I guess that's the definition of chill.
If Netflix asked you to make this documentary, make the emo Matt have a friend who's just super chill, if you said, what about a guy who has a coffee shop, he checks in on every now and then, they would say, too chill.
Too chill.
They say, it's way too chill. Yeah.
There's no drama there. It's way too chill. Yeah. So yeah, that's how chill his life is. He raises kids.
Are you close to them?
And yeah. Yep.
Is everybody still in Portland?
Is what?
Everybody still in Portland?
Yeah. Brothers in Portland, sisters in Portland. Mom and dad go back and forth between Portland and Palm Springs.
They still together?
They're not. They are roommates in Palm Springs. They've been divorced for 30 years and they're still roommates, no joke, in Palm Springs. And then they have separate places when they come back to Oregon.
So they're friends?
They're friends.
And they're roommates because they share this place, but do they go at the same time?
Same time. My dad flies, my mom drives. So my dad will fly in. They chase the weather. So when it's winter in Portland, they head to Palm Springs. My dad will fly in and my mom will make the drive. She at least wants to make sure my dad's there first to kind of feel, I guess, you know, safe living there. And then she'll find a family member or friend to drive her because she's scared of flying.
Have they remarried?
No.
Are they single, both of them?
Single.
How old are you when they got divorced?
I think I was eight. I think I was eight or nine.
How much older is your sister?
She's 9 years older.
Wow.
She's 43.
So she was probably a senior in high school when they got divorced.
Yeah.
Is there, because I know when you're a kid and the parents get divorced, I've heard that like you want to try to get your parents back together. At this point, it's over.
It's done.
But is it? They're single friends, travel together.
Well, here's the thing. I want to say that they're friendly to each other. They're not friends that are, they're not hanging out.
Why are they going to Palm Springs together?
Because it's affordable. They don't have money to have separate places. So my dad has this mobile home and they built another part of the mobile home with like a kitchenette and like another bathroom that my mom lives at. So she lives in the back of this house and like they're friendly and like she'll like check in on him and if she has extra food, she'll give, like they're being friendly with each other, but they definitely don't hang out. Like my mom goes and hangs out with like, plays ping pong with like the lady down the corner, rides her bike with Suzanne and you know, that kind of stuff.
You go home for Thanksgiving or any holidays?
I'll drive to Palm Springs around Thanksgiving time. Maybe not the day of, but around Thanksgiving, I'll go to Palm Springs and have dinner, take my parents out to dinner.
So you have family dinners with your parents still?
Yeah.
That's so interesting. It seems so unusual.
Like it is
that's
unusual.
That's super sweet.
Well, to be able
to still share that.
So when's the last time, do your parents not see each other?
My parents are together.
Oh, they're together.
Yes.
And when's the last time you had dinner with them?
They come out to California a few times a year. I go home once or twice a year. They're coming out next week. I'll have dinner with them then.
So you're saying that your situation and my situation are unusual because most people don't have...
No, what's unusual is to have parents that got divorced when you were in elementary school. You go and visit them. You don't go see your mom or your dad.
Yeah, I see
now,
them.
Now, on weddings, I'm sure they all come together, but you go, they're together and you go and visit them.
Yep.
But they've been divorced for a long time. That's what's unusual to me.
It is very unusual. People don't get it. A lot of people are like, wait, they have to still be hooking up. First of all, they're way past that. There's not a horny drop of blood in their system. At all.
An HDOB?
There's not.
I could argue that on that, but you know them better than I.
So they're just, the thing is, you know, they don't come from money. So with the money that they do have, they just decide to be, you know, very frugal. And my mom cannot afford to get a different place, but she wanted to be in Palm Springs. So my dad just said, hey, I'll build onto my house. I want to do it anyway. And you can live back there. It is strange. I get that. Because you would think if you're divorced, if you want to get divorced, you don't want to be near that person anymore.
Not necessarily, but yeah, that is kind of the standard.
It's a standard, not always.
Yeah,
and I think that they're the exception.
What's your relationship? What's Ariel's relationship with them?
She likes them both. Yeah, she's hung out with them twice, once in Portland, once in Palm Springs. So it hasn't been like that often. We're both super busy, so we don't get to. I don't get to see my family that often. It's like a twice a year kind of thing. I'd like to. Palm Springs is 2 hours away. I'd like to go there a few times a year, but I only make it a couple times. But Ariel loves them. They get along.
And congrats, man. That's the dream.
It's the dream.
You have your best friend.
Yep.
You know, and you guys live together, and you do bits, and you laugh.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
We have a house together. We have a cute.
Oh, you have a house. I didn't know it was a house.
We got a house together. Moved away out towards out to, like past Pasadena, so it's very, very quiet over there. That's why I like to leave, you know, before traffic hour. But like, it's really nice. We live in a nice neighborhood. We have a nice house, and it's definitely a slower paced life. But I've been in Hollywood now for 14 years. I've lived in North Hollywood, West Hollywood, Studio City, Malibu, Santa Monica. I've lived everywhere, and I've seen it. I've done it. And now that I'm, you know,
it's about ready.
Not single, family time.
Because we do got to wrap it up. I want to get into now. No filters. Gloves are off.
Okay.
Here's what we all came to see.
Yeah.
Here it goes.
Go.
You are what people refer to as a social media influencer.
Yes.
With that comes a bit of stigma.
Mm-hmm.
Do you agree with that?
Well, in what way? Yeah, okay. Yeah, please explain.
I hear a lot of people, especially because I'm friends with a lot of comedians, mm-hmm. and their comedians rely heavily on the social media following. Because that's what sells tickets. That's what gets them booked. And if somebody has 500,000 followers, they feel that they could fill a 400-seat room in a popular city. So it's easier for them. A lot of comedians don't have the same type of followers
yeah.
that influencers have. And they hate on it. Mm-hmm. And they're not funny. Vine isn't funny. Instagram famous. Vine famous. Fuck them. They don't deserve to. Like, really, like... hate on it, not any person in particular,
but just in general the influencer thing.
Yes,
I get it.
This new ecosystem that exists because, like you said earlier, people now have their own television networks, and if a television show gets 3 million views, that's a successful enough, especially on cable. That's a successful show. People that have 3 million followers get 10 million views on their things. I mean, they have power now.
For sure, yeah,
and there's no one stopping them from it. There's no notes. They could do whatever they want.
Yep.
So, people don't like that.
Yeah.
People are jealous of it.
Well, I think that comedians might be jealous about it because these people are taking their spot in, like you said, like they think they can sell tickets. So, they'll put this influencer in a room for stand-up before they put someone else. Is that kind of what you're referring to?
But I don't think that's sustainable. I don't think they're really... First of all, no one's taking anyone's spot. When anyone thinks that's mine, maybe if you're going for the same role and someone else gets it, yeah. I guess kind of. But there's a million stages out there.
Yeah.
And also, if somebody sells tickets and then they're not funny by minute five, it's not going to continue.
Yeah.
So they're not really taking anybody's spot. I don't quite understand. And also, I don't know if it's a jealousy thing. I'm filling in the blanks.
Yeah.
I don't quite understand where the hate comes from. I just do know. First of all, when anybody is successful, people shit on them. It's just the way it goes. Everybody hates people who are successful, and it comes with the territory.
Yep.
So this isn't about success. Let me rephrase that. This is about a particular kind of success, one that people feel is unearned.
Yeah.
Also, it's very interesting to me. You haven't experienced this. You don't realize this.
No, I do. I know it exists. I do know it exists. But, well, here's the thing. I know it exists. I know it's out there. I'm friends with comedians that obviously are my friend, so mm-hmm. they don't necessarily, at least in front of me, hate on me. But what they kind of have to understand is, and some people can have that overnight blow up on Instagram or whatever, but that kind of comedy that's an overnight blow up is very like random, dumb, viral videos.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying about stage show. It's not sustainable.
It's not sustainable, but there's a whole other side of social media influencers who have posted videos for the last 7 years and they're just now getting big. So for instance, on Vine, I started in 2013, it's now 2019, and over the last 2 years, I've been able to make a career out of it. Mm-hmm. So like, it takes time. It's not an overnight thing. There might be some people who discover me tomorrow that think like, look at this douchebag. He, you know, he makes this money now and he just blew up. And it's like, well, there was no just blow up. It was literally shooting videos every day, editing videos every day, writing scripts every day, casting friends, locations. I made that my life for years. Years, hours on hours on hours, years on years, new bits, new sketches. This doesn't work. I'll try this. Like it's a lot more complicated than people think.
It takes so much time.
A lot of time.
It takes so much time. The production side of it alone with locations, with lights, with help, with setting it up, with writing it, with costumes, getting there, executing, then to have to edit it, which takes however long the video is, it's per 10 seconds, it's usually about, you know, 25 minutes of editing.
Yeah.
It takes so long. I don't think people realize it. I also think, I don't think people realize that Instagram isn't stand-up, isn't television. I mean, the skill sets could translate from one to another. People who do stand-up, there's kind of a feud between stand-up comedians and improvisation comedians. Not once you've been doing this for enough time where you have a living, but usually when people are first coming up, fuck, improv's whack, stand-up's stupid, and everyone makes fun of each other. So those are two completely different sports. Mm. Instagram is its own, social media is its own genre.
It is.
First of all, they're minute videos max. Second, your audience is there to see you. A lot of times when you're doing a show, people are there for comedy, not you in particular. You're literally building a brand.
Mm-hmm.
I think when people get upset, it's because they're not good at or they don't work at this on this particular stage. And they think this is comedy. That's not comedy. And there's a bit of judgment to it.
That makes sense.
I think that's where it comes from. I think that Instagram... when I say Instagram, it's social media because Instagram's all I really use. I use Twitter kind of, but Instagram is king to me.
Yeah.
Is so new still that it's kind of the Wild West. That's why when you were saying when Vine came out, you're getting followers like crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's like when television first came out, there's only 8 channels. There's only so much content. So when you get out on the ground floor, they become fans of yours. It's just a very interesting ecosystem. And I don't quite, I don't understand how it works. Like you said, Facebook, nothing. All of a sudden, this one goes viral. I mean, it's hard to control that.
It's hard to control. It's really hard to tell.
But also, what you started on Vine not that long ago. Vine doesn't even exist anymore.
Yeah.
Where does it go? How do you like when you said to me, "I want to do this commercial while I'm still relevant"?
Yeah.
That's so honest because if Instagram goes away, then what?
Well, hopefully, I would be prepared to jump onto the next trend. So for instance,
that's right. It's so important to find the trend.
You have to find the trend, jump on it and move your audience. So when Vine started, when we started noticing the Vine numbers go down, I kind of panicked and I started getting everyone over to Instagram. I would do a Vine every week or two. And I'd say some creative way of saying, follow me on Instagram.
Yeah.
And I would get people on Instagram. And every single time I would do it, I'd get like 2,000 people here, 3,000 people here, 4,000 people there. And that's how I built my Instagram.
It's like
I moved my audience over.
If the earth was dying, we have to find a new planet, basically.
You have to go find a new planet. You had. Instagram is still king.
Yeah.
I don't know how, I mean, I feel like it'll be around for a while.
Do you see anything else coming? Because new stuff comes up all the time, but it's
kind of unfortunate, but like TikTok is a really big platform that's blowing up.
Yeah, I've been seeing those.
I don't want to get on there.
Do you think it's because you'd be a small fish in that pond?
No, not at all. I don't want to get on there because it's associated to a bunch of cheesy people who blow up. That's why. Instagram is a little bit different. It's a little bit more mature. It's a little bit more nicely curated. TikTok's very, it's just a different platform.
I feel like Instagram is the new website now. Instead of having a mattcutshall.com, you just go to my Instagram.
Go to my Instagram, yes.
Because you could have all your contact info. Yeah. They could message you.
Exactly.
And that you could control your content.
Yeah.
So yeah, it does feel more professional.
Instagram's more professional and, you know, it's still growing for me. It's not like it's declining. As long as I'm growing on Instagram and more people are joining Instagram daily, I feel pretty safe. If another platform pops up that I think is going to be big one day, I'll probably jump on it.
So the reason I've come up to you a few times before we connected as friends on Instagram and then had our first hangout now was because I always thought you were super funny. And I knew of you through Ariel because I've been friends with her for a few years.
Yeah.
And I can't find the right word. I wasn't intimidated by you. But the reason I didn't want to linger was because it felt like you found your world and you were the guy in it.
Yeah.
And the only times I saw you was in situations where I think you were there. I remember one of them was at the Baby Driver premiere.
Yeah.
And like the few places I found you, my read was you were there because of Instagram. Like you were there to probably people asked you to come to promote their movie or whatever it may be. So I almost felt like you're at work and this guy's good at what he does. I don't want to just, hey man, how you doing? I've seen good stuff.
Yeah.
I'm out.
Got it.
And it was like, it was kind of like I'm coming up to you while you're at work. And I didn't knock on that guy's door because I don't want to knock on his door while he's working. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't know. I'm a little tone deaf to stuff. So when am I coming in and doing bits? And you're like, you need to be doing stuff. So you kind of have, and I'm projecting this, but I feel you have this professional aura about yourself, about Instagram, which in a very cool way is fucking weird, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, but that's why you're doing what you're doing.
It's so funny that you say that because I take it so professionally, even more than like a lot of my peers and even more than Ariel, and it bothers her a little bit. Not that she hates on it. She's just kind of like, in her mind, she's like, dude, like, it's just an Instagram video. Like, calm down.
It's your career.
But the thing is, it is my career. Right. It's how I make money. And I feel too, I know girls can really thrive on Instagram. And I'm not taking this away from Ariel. She got to where she is because she's funny. She's also very beautiful, so people want to follow her. But my point is it is pretty difficult being a guy to find an audience on Instagram. You have to put out good mm-hmm. content and you have to be funny. So for me, I'm like, fuck, this is paying me. I gotta go for this. So I'm professional wherever I go.
Dude, you even said before you got here, hey, my assistant's dropping off some camera equipment 10 minutes before I get there. I don't even know what that means, but I was thinking like, dude, this dude's pro.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, you know, I'm definitely, while it's here, I'm like grabbing it by the horns and I'm going for it, you know?
Yeah, that's awesome.
So I take it very seriously. And if a brand's paying me to be there and promote, I'm going to be there very seriously. I'm going to have a good time. I'm not like some suit guy who's like can't let, you know, cut loose and have fun. Like, I'm a fun dude, but I do take my work very, you know, very seriously because I love doing it too.
Mm-hmm.
I love it. And when I get to shoot these funny videos, that's when I get to have fun. So like the other day we were shooting, I actually shot a thing with, Ariel was in it. It was for Febreze. I did a Febreze ad. And so I had a whole crew come over and I knew I was so busy that day. I knew I just had to get it done. So we had like a 10 a.m. call time and had our crew come over, and Ariel's call time was 10:30. And I'm pretty strict on that kind of stuff. Like, not like you need to get down here, but like I'll say, can you be ready by 10:30? And she'll say, yeah, I'll be down there by 10:30. And it's like a professional mini set. If I didn't run it like that, instead of being an hour shoot, it would be 3 hours because this person would come at 10 and this person would come at 10:45. And then someone guy would come in with coffee and some food and they'd want to eat first and they want to catch up. And then so-and-so wouldn't be ready. That's how I used to run it. And it just, videos took forever. Mm-hmm. And so I started getting more strategic with my time and just, yeah.
When I see you posting videos, multiple videos, and I don't know what it is, because yeah. I don't know what, especially on your story, I don't know if it's an ad or not yet until I see it was an ad. And then it's Ariel, who is, might as well literally be a cartoon character in some of these things, you know?
Yeah.
And her nose and her lips, and she's like, it's like, what the fuck is happening? Yeah. I love it. I love her. I don't know what the fuck is happening.
Yeah, how does she do
that? And then after I get to the third story, because I always watch because I want to know, is this an ad or not?
Yeah.
And then it's an ad for, you guys have been setting up for 30 seconds that your stomach's hurt, and now it's for Tums. And I'm watching this, oh, laughing shit. At Ariel's choices, me for being too invested.
Yeah.
And then to find out these guys just made 20 G's selling Tums.
Yeah.
What the fuck is this, bro?
Dude,
it's weird. I mean, it's amazing.
Dude, it's really weird. I'm just so used to it now because I've been, Vine is what blew that up, by the way.
I know.
Vine is what blew up the whole social media influencer brand deal thing.
Yeah, there was no, Vine Famous was the first
Vine
something famous.
Vine Famous was the first being social media yeah. famous. And I caught that wave. I was lucky enough to be on Vine when it happened. I'm lucky that I stumbled across it when I did.
I wanted to tell you a cool Vine Famous. When I first realized Vine Famous is a thing,
yeah.
I was on a show on NBC called Undateable.
Yeah.
And on that show, there was me, Chris D'Elia, Ron Funches, and Brent Morin. The four of us are stand-up comics. So we went on tour a couple of times. For two of the seasons, we did like 8-10 cities, whatever.
Yeah.
We were in Chicago, and Kevin Durant was in the lobby. And Brent and I are huge basketball fans. Chris, I don't know if you can name 5 players. And we went up and, you know, there's some people you got to ask for pictures with. Kevin Durant is one of them.
He's one of them for sure.
And Chris was over there and he said to Chris, Chris didn't say anything to him. He said to Chris, hey, you're that Vine Famous dude, right? And Chris is like, you just say famous or something like that, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, we're asking this dude for pictures and Durant knows fucking Chris.
From Vine.
Because of Vine.
From Vine.
Fucking wow,
bro.
Wow.
When I first started getting recognized on Vine, I was mind blown because I was working at a restaurant and I served a table and these two girls just freaked out and they like were staring at me and I'm like,
oh, this is, you're famous while you're still a waiter.
I was famous on Vine when I was still a waiter. And so I go to this table. This was my first like moment. Uh-huh. And I walk up and they both like look at me like really weird. And I'm like, hey, can I get you guys some water? Or like, you know, like, I just didn't know what was going on. And she's like, oh my God. And I'm like, what's up? And she's like, why are you working here? And I still didn't get it then.
Did that make you feel embarrassed at all? Or
no.
Did it make you think it was cool? How does that feel?
I thought it was cool. Yeah. And I was like, and I didn't know what she meant. And I was like, I need a job. And she's like, you're like, literally, you're like our favorite Viner. And blah, blah, blah. And like, don't you do, and then we started talking about, she's like, don't you do deals and this and that? I was like, well, I just started getting deals. But that was my first moment of that. And it's weird because I feel like there's a, it's like a snowball effect. The second I got recognized one time, every other day it'd be at the Grove and this person would come up. And then it just, and then when at its peak, what's crazy is, and Vine Famous is different than it is now. I will still go out and get recognized now, but not as often as Vine, because the Vine videos would be so viral and end up on YouTube and here and there. And in the peak of Vine, the top Viners could go to a mall and get mobs of people that would rush.
Did you like that or did that bother you?
I liked it. I liked it because I've always wanted to be in entertainment, and part of entertainment is the fame and the attention. So I liked it.
What does that attention mean to you?
It just...
Is it validating that you're good at something?
Yes. It validated my work. It meant that people are fans of what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. I'm making people laugh. I'm creating videos. I now have fans because I'm clearly getting recognized for it. It feels good. It still feels good, but it did start getting annoying when I was like, oh shit, like, okay, for instance, I'll have a whiskey and I don't smoke cigarettes and I don't like smoking cigarettes, but if I have a whiskey, I like to smoke cigarettes. And I was out in public and I was like having a whiskey and like a cig, just, that was just my thing. And these two girls came up and like took a picture and I was like, oh shit. And so like, I hid my cigarette, and then that kind of stuff started happening where I was like, oh man.
You need to sell something accurately.
Yes. I'm a little bit in the limelight now, to where I kind of got to be a little bit more careful. I don't want to seem like a reckless guy. I don't want to promote smoking to a younger audience. Uh-huh. So I started becoming really careful.
Yeah. So I noticed that you don't swear on your social.
Yeah.
And then you invited me into your Instagram that's just for friends. And you're like, here's where I'll say fuck.
Yeah.
And it's like, damn.
Dude, so when I first posted, I just discovered like the friends and family little button. When I first discovered that, I did it, and me and Ariel were just going crazy. And people that just watch my stories just aren't used to it. Like even my friends. And I had a couple friends be like, dude, I was casually scrolling through, then suddenly like your ass is out and you're screaming at the camera and you're whatever. He goes, dude, it was crazy. I thought that you just didn't give a fuck anymore.
When are you ever going to be that, sell that? Just what you want to do.
Well,
could you not because of advertising?
I make a living by being a PG-13 personality.
Right.
If I decided to be rated R, there would be some brands that work with me, but my money would probably increase by like 2/3, maybe more.
How much do you need to be funny when you're doing an ad? What's your priority?
My priority is just to, I don't have a level of funny. I just have to make it funny. If the brand doesn't allow me to be creative enough to make it as funny as I want it to be, I'll actually just pass. I don't do everything. In fact, I actually just got an offer from TikTok and I didn't want to do it.
Do it.
And give you the money?
No.
In increments?
Do it. Do it.
What? Well,
here's how you...
Okay, go ahead. And I'll tell you why I won't in a second.
What do they want? What do they ask for you to do?
They want me to sign up to have a TikTok account. They want me to create a funny video that lives on TikTok and then post it onto my Instagram story and then tell people to swipe up to follow me on TikTok.
Great. Here's what you do.
Go.
You make a TikTok video with you standing outside of a guitar center looking at the guitar that will be yours. Oh, yes, it will be yours. But you can't afford it. Wait a minute. What if I make a TikTok video and they give me fucking cake, dude? Post it on Instagram and you say, yo, I'm not sure about TikTok. I'm not. I'm still not. Seems pretty popular. I don't know what's going on. Full disclosure, I need this fucking axe, dude. So I'm posting it here to get my axe. You buy your axe, you go and you fucking jam out on TikTok, whatever, however that works. Boom, money in the, literally.
Money
in the bank.
Money in the bank.
And then you get to make your video about how I'm only doing this because you can still be authentic about it.
That's a brand that would probably let me do that, but that's a rare example because they're an app that's a little bit more edgy. If that was another brand, they would say no.
You could write, dude.
You're saying write a bit around it.
I'm saying write a bit that is honest to your intention.
Yeah.
Without stepping on their brand.
Yeah.
Just do anything.
Well, I'll tell you what I did. So there was one week when I rolled out, like, I posted like 4 brand deals in a row, and that was like, oh God. Like, and I didn't have time to shoot content to post in between. I was pretty embarrassed. I got some DMs from people being like, dude, like, and by the way, people, please don't text us this, because be happy for us. You follow us and we started making money from this, and this is our right. This is the way that we can make a living so we can keep posting for you. But anyway, got some DMs and people being like, dude, like, I've followed you since Vine, man. I love you. One of my favorites, but man, I had to unfollow, man. Too many ads.
You got to make the ads content.
Yeah.
And well, I feel like you usually do.
The thing is, it doesn't matter. If it says, it could be a regular video where I'm doing my regular thing and there's a right. Dyson vacuum in the background. If it says ad, people want to hate. So anyway, these people hated, and I posted a story and I was real with my audience. And I said, hey guys, just so you guys know, I'm aware that I'm posting all these brand deals, but I want you to think of it like this. No one gets mad when they see Kevin Hart's special on TV and they run an ad. No one gets mad when they watch their favorite stars on a television and then an ad pops up.
But it's great logic. It's a completely different medium, because people are on that because it's quick. They're not watching television. And that's why you have so many opportunities, because this isn't television.
Yeah.
Instagram isn't television. Instagram is, I could be on it for 3 hours. I could be on it for 25 seconds.
Yeah.
And when their time, I caught myself scrolling and I saw a cat that on its paw, it was not Photoshopped. It was a video. There was a cat and somebody basketballs and they set it up on the paws. And then they went away. Cat spinning 2 basketballs.
Yeah.
I didn't even finish it.
And then I just
I'm just saying.
Oh, because you wanted the next thing.
It was the most incredible. It was 6 years ago. That's the most incredible thing I've ever seen in my entire life.
Yeah.
I'm seeing a cat spinning 2 things that I love so much in one video with an unbelievable rare talent. Cats is a globetrotter.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I looked at it for 3 seconds. I'm like, eh, cool.
Yeah, let me look at the next. You got it. Thing. You're like, done. I get it.
How am I not watching it? So people don't want to. So I just think that ads are different. And I think that, you know better than me, but I don't believe that if it says hashtag ad, that people are going to be upset.
Keep this in mind. So I have 700 and something thousand followers.
800 some thousand. How do you not know that?
I don't have 800 something.
Oh no, I thought no. I saw.
I think it's like a little over 700,000.
Okay.
So anyway, it is 715,000 people. Yes, that's a lot of people. Of those people, I don't get that much hate. People, my audience has kind of like learned to appreciate and love me. So like if I get 2 comments of this many people, that's not a big deal. So, but the thing is, because I started getting those comments that one week is when I was like, you know what? I want to be real open with my audience. And I got a lot of DMs from people being like, dude, that's so cool that you were vulnerable with us and just kind of broke it down and shared that with us, because we love and respect you and we've never thought about it like that. You are an entertainer and you need to get paid. And all we think is,
oh, that's great.
Yeah. So they actually related to me, which was really cool.
Is there something where you could have like the fifth of every month is fucking ad day? And you just post like 5-10 ads that day?
And everyone knows what to expect. They're like, dude, the ads are coming out.
Yeah.
No, it's all random. Like I'll get an email tomorrow. I'll get an email, let's just say today. And they'll say, hey, this is last minute, but can Matt come to this, to the premiere of this movie and then come do an Instagram story and a photo and then post tomorrow. It'll just be like that.
And then
they dictate, for the most part.
And then they send your manager a check?
And then they send your manager a check.
Wow.
Yeah. I know. It's pretty wild.
That's incredible.
It is. It's pretty crazy. It's honestly, when I first started on Vine, so I have a business management now. I don't see the money that comes in. When I didn't have a manager and didn't have a business manager, I would just go and do this thing, and then a check would come, and it would just be a $2,500 check. It would just show up, and I'm like, oh my God. And then I would do like, then I started doing so many videos and just shooting personal content, then branded content, and then personal, and then suddenly like there'd be like a $5,000 check here, $2,500 here. And it was the coolest thing ever to be like, holy shit, I'm an entertainer for a living. It's what I always wanted to do. Was I just wanted to entertain for a living. And I was doing that. I built my own audience and I was entertaining for a living. It was pretty surreal when I first got my first entertainment checks.
Yeah, I've imagined, because it's still surreal to me. I spend so much time making, like I'm out and I love making Instagram videos and people like, and I'm like asking people to do this and go over there and nobody wants to do it. And I get it. I know I'm being annoying, but like, let's fucking make funny stuff.
Yeah.
It's so, and Matt, I love doing it.
yeah.
to get paid to make those things yeah. is like an odd new, like, oh my God, I would, that would be amazing.
Shit. So you would do brand deals, right?
I would not do anything but brand deals. I would change my name to Rick Glassman Brand Deals.
I would love to see if my manager can get you a brand deal just for the fun of it, and then we'll have to show it on here.
Please.
Should we try?
Do you have any idea of what type of thing it would be? It would be something you're already connected with?
No, well,
get me a brand deal, dude. Get me a rated R brand deal, and it's going to be all clean, but at the end I'm just going to show my dick.
Here's a great example. Pop Chips is coming out with a new packaging that look like they're selling single chips for, it's like more of like a gag gift. They're selling single chips in a condom-like wrapper. And it's called Ridged
for
your pleasure.
Okay.
And it says they're called, actually, I got to show you this. I sent this to Ariel. So to be completely transparent, for my brand,
I can't
do that.
Fucking.
I can't post about that. I can't post about a chip that's in a condom package because I work with McDonald's and Coca-Cola and these brands that would see that and be like, oh, that's cheap. We don't want to work with them anymore. Like there's like definitely a, there's a, okay, here, there. It's called Just the Chip. And it's these box ribbed for pleasure, right? And no joke. So they reached out because they want me to do one. It's just not for me. It's not for my brand. I think it's fun. I think it's hilarious. I think it's funny. I just can't risk it and post that on my page, but you can.
All right.
So we'll see.
I already know the commercial I'm doing.
Okay.
The commercial is beautiful girl comes over. Okay. I'm a little nervous. She's hitting on me, and I recognize that she's interested, but I have a little bit of performance anxiety.
Okay.
And we end up fooling around, and I go soft inside of her. And she said, is there something wrong? And I look into the camera, and I say, I have performance anxiety. And I'm just a little nervous. And then I start to sweat, and she gets a little weirded out. And then she gets up, and she gets dressed, and you could see some side boob. This girl's a fucking nine. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then she leaves. And then I'm laying in bed, and I'm just, oh, fucking, I can't. And I have a realization. And I take out the chip, and I eat it.
Mm-hmm.
And I look into the camera, and I say, penis, chips. I don't know. I got a thing on it. I thought I'd find something and I didn't.
didn't quite get there. Penis, chips.
I love starting sentences. And
dude, I
get so mad when I don't find
it,
though.
I'm legit going to reach out to this girl and send her your link and say, this guy will do it fairly cheap.
No, I'm not doing it for less than two Gs.
Okay, so you need $2,000 to do it.
Minimum. But I don't know if I want to start at that. If they could send me an offer.
So you have, let's see. You got 28,000 followers, 5,000. So there's 5,000 views there, 1,200 views there.
I'll give you 20% of it if you then tell them you can't post it on your thing, but you'll like send a link to it or something. Could you do that, or does that mess up your McDonald's money?
Yeah, I couldn't do that.
You bitch.
I can't do it.
You fucking bitch. It's a chip.
Dude, we have to get you this brand deal.
Yeah, I don't get out of bed for less than two G's. That's okay. Just the way Daddy works.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I mean, I appreciate the opportunity. It would be fun, but there's no way.
Okay. You want two G's for this. I don't think they would pay that, but I can try.
Okay.
We have to try.
Okay.
That's hilarious.
Great.
Okay.
Well, I think we got to wrap it up.
Let's wrap it up.
And that's a Pop Chip called back.
Blabbity blue. Scoop D. Oh, yeah. Yep, yep.